You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we get into the nitty-gritty of the ONNX model format as well as the ONNX runtime. It's pretty amazing, and in the end, you can actually run your own AI pretty quickly. Make sure you tune in. Hello, welcome to this episode of the AI Show. We're going to learn all about ONNX, the Open Neural Network Exchange. I'm pretty excited to be here with Vinitra. How are you doing, my friend?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Seth.
Fantastic. What do you do?
So I work on the ONNX engineering team as part of the AI frameworks team here at Microsoft.
So I've heard about ONNX, and I've even converted stuff to ONNX, but can you explain to our audience what exactly is ONNX?
Right. So ONNX actually stands for the Open Neural Network Exchange, mm-hmm. and it's specifically a format to represent deep learning models. Okay. And the benefit of using ONNX is that you're able to translate from a variety of frameworks into ONNX, and it's kind of the standard for deep learning libraries. It specifies a set of operators.
So I understand, like, so basically, like, if I like PyTorch and someone else likes TensorFlow, the outputs are obviously different. ONNX allows you to have like this format where it's all common. So I get that part. But why would someone want to do that? What's the benefit of doing that?
So the benefit of doing that is multifold. One of them is that ONNX is able to leverage graph optimizations.
Okay.
And you're able to use different runtime inference frameworks to take advantage of those.
I see. Yeah. So you're saying that, okay, so now I'm understanding this, because like for some reason I'm like, okay, it's all the same format, I can work with other developers, but now you're saying from the inference perspective, if you have something in a common format and everyone agrees to it, then hardware vendors can optimize for that, number one. And then number two, as you're doing conversions, you can find errors in the, or maybe graph things that can be simplified. And is this something that you do when you're converting as well?
Yeah, so there is an optimizer when in the conversion tools, but the main advantage to using ONNX is you're able to take advantage of whichever hardware optimization comes next. So you're able to translate between these frameworks with ease and then choose whichever inference engine you would like.
So let's talk about the actual converter. So now that I'm understanding, this is actually super helpful, because now I understand it's not, because I think of it like as the PDF of deep learning, right, which is kind of cool, but it's only cool if there's a lot of different PDF readers. And you're saying that now that we have a format, then a lot of vendors can take advantage of that. Is it hard to go from what I'm already doing into ONNX? And that's the part that maybe I'm asking for help, because someone might be thinking this is going to add a little bit to my workflow.
Right.
Is there something we can do to help with that?
Yeah. So again, the advantage of ONNX is that it's supported by a large amount of industry partners. And that means that a lot of these frameworks have built-in exporters, for example, PyTorch and a few others. Mm-hmm. And some of the other ones are able to leverage converters in ONNX ML tools. So scikit-learn, TensorFlow, Keras to ONNX, all of these are just simple convert commands that convert your model that's a saved protobuf mm-hmm. file or something you load in whichever framework of your choice into the ONNX model format.
I see. So you're saying it's as easy as making an extra call in your framework of choice or loading up some tool that does the conversion.
Exactly.
So there's not really a lot of extra work that you have to do, hopefully.
Yes, not at all.
So what if someone already has this and they want to experiment with converting to ONNX? Is there something we can do to help even then?
Right. So if someone already has ONNX mm-hmm. and they want to experiment, we've created this ONNX ecosystem Docker file where you have all the ONNX converters loaded, you have ONNX, you have all of the different frameworks, and you also have ONNX runtime. So
it's pretty easy to do.
It's pretty easy to do that.
Yeah, because I set up my Conda environment in a very special way, and I don't want to install a bunch of things, because I tried installing some of this stuff once, and I was missing something or other happened. Yeah. But you're saying now with the Docker file, you can just use it. Can you show us how to do that?
Yes, of course. So let's take a quick look here. This Docker file has already been uploaded to Docker Hub, and what we're going to do right here is, right now, I've already pulled this Docker file. This is all you'll have to do. You just have to have Docker. And then after that, you can run this command, and it launches the Jupyter Notebook server.
Oh, okay, so this is where I was confused. I'm like, if you run this Docker, is it going to look for all of your protobuf files and confirm? No, it's loading a Jupyter server where you can actually do some work.
Exactly.
Awesome.
So in this Jupyter server, you can see that there are some converter scripts from all of these different frameworks. Uh-huh. And all of these environments have already been loaded. So, you know, if you have a model file, it's as easy as uploading it. And here I've recently just uploaded an ML model file, which is an Apple CoreML machine learning framework file. And all that I would have to do, go through the script. In this case, all of the imports already exist. Uh-huh. Change the name of the model, which is going to be document classification. In this case, this model just takes a set of articles and classifies what kind of document it is.
Got it.
Change our model name for the output file, finish that, and we have our model being saved. So now we open up, it's as easy as pie. So
yeah, I mean, that's pretty cool. Like, the thing I like about this the most is that, like, every time I do something in Python and I need to pip install or conda install, I'm like, I don't want to mess up what I'm doing. With this Docker file, you're able to pull this image down, run the container, and then experiment with the ONNX stuff yourself and download it if you want, right?
Exactly. So we can then confirm that the model works by running through this checker.
And this is also in the Docker file.
This is all in the Docker file. So your entire environment is installed.
Cool.
You're welcome to use it. You can check that our model is checked and see we're passing in the same name as our previous output. And we can start an ONNX runtime inference session.
Okay.
So this is something else I wanted to talk about. I'm not too sure.
Yeah, I do. I do want to talk about this, because this is interesting, because I actually did something a little bit ago where I ran an inference session in C Sharp, which is kind of cool, because now that we have this exchange format and everyone's agreed on what it looks like, you can run these inference sessions in any type of tooling that you want. Is that right?
Exactly. And the benefit of it is it actually takes advantage of hardware optimizations from partners like NVIDIA and Intel to make our inference for ONNX models even faster.
That's amazing. So now I'm starting to get the full story, right? Because I think initially what I did is I was thinking this as like a, but now like it's just a format. It's like, this is good. Now everyone has the same format. Oh, but now you're saying not only does that enable hardware people to do like, oh, now that we know this is a standard, then we can like make our hardware super fast for that. Number one, it also allows people that make frameworks or tools or whatever ingest these ONNX models in a predictable way.
Right.
Irrespective of language. I'm used to doing all this stuff in Python, like maybe some of you are. But I've been able to load up ONNX models directly in C Sharp, and it ran beautifully. And all I had to do was look at the model, know what was coming, what was going in and what was coming out, and it was great. So exactly. is the runtime something that we provide, or where does the runtime come from? Is everyone making a runtime?
Right. So the ONNX runtime is actually from Microsoft itself.
Mm-hmm.
So it's meant to host three main ideas.
Okay.
So the ONNX runtime is important because it's an open source scoring engine for ONNX models.
Sure.
And the benefit to using it is that it's guaranteed to run any ONNX model. Right now, it's compatible with the most recent release, which is ONNX 1.4 Opset 10. It's high performance in that it often gains even more performance than native runtimes that you're running ONNX on. So if you uploaded an ONNX model in some other frameworks or runtimes, you would see a better performance with ONNX runtime for the most part.
I see.
And it's cross-platform, meaning that all you would have to do to install it is just a simple pip install on Mac or on Linux or on Windows.
So you mentioned something interesting, and hopefully you can get into this. You talked about like the version, but then you talked about the offset. What is the difference between like the ONNX runtime version or the ONNX offset? Can you describe what those differences are?
Right. So ONNX versions and operator sets are essentially a similar things. Mm-hmm. There's continual development from Microsoft, Facebook, and a couple of the other large industry partners mm-hmm. that continually contribute to the ONNX spec.
Okay.
And every time that gets refreshed, every new version that comes out, they update the operator set. So
is that like a matrix multiply operator or like a E log of something operator? Is that what we're talking about?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
So we're talking about all the different operators that can be represented in deep learning libraries.
Got it.
And usually what happens is that the ONNX spec uh-huh. has to represent a set of operators. And in those operators, you can represent the translations from other libraries. So
I
from CoreML, from TensorFlow, from various others, you can convert to ONNX and then convert from ONNX back to any other library.
I see. So what's happening is, like, there's a set of operations that, like, for example, W transpose X plus B is your standard dense layer.
Yeah.
That's going to be a single operator inside of the ONNX definition. And so whenever it sees a dense layer in either Keras or inside of PyTorch, it's going to be like, this operator. And it turns out that the opset changes with every version and there's more operations that are added.
Right.
I got it. Okay, that makes sense. Because, for example, in sequence models, there might be a different operation as opposed to just a dense layer.
Exactly.
Okay, so now I'm understanding, and thank goodness you're doing that. So anything else you want to add about ONNX?
It's great. There's a pretty wide industry adoption, and we're excited to incorporate it with ONNX Runtime. So ONNX Runtime is Microsoft's own inference engine.
Okay.
But you can deploy ONNX models on a variety of inference engines.
So my understanding is that the ONNX Runtime is part of the whole Windows ecosystem. Is that right?
That's correct. Okay. So ONNX Runtime is included on every single machine that is running Windows.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. So over 1 billion devices now currently have ONNX Runtime. And the benefit of using it is that it leverages execution provider speedups.
Okay.
So let's say you have an Intel chip that's running MKLDNN or NGRAPH or an NVIDIA processor that has TensorRT or GPU capabilities. ONNX Runtime can be specified to leverage those speedups and make your model run faster. And we've seen speedups kind of across the board with a lot of different frameworks, but also especially in comparison to native runtimes like TensorFlow, PyTorch, et cetera.
Awesome. So now, Mike, let's hopefully we can get into the nitty-gritty. Is there an example where this is being leveraged like in a real actual problem where you're seeing substantial benefits?
Yes. Okay. So I'm really excited to bring this amazing story here today. Mm-hmm. The Bing multimedia team is responsible for image search.
Okay.
Or specifically, you can understand that there are some queries that are really hard to search for images. So for example, pencil erasers that look like tools.
Right?
How would you be able to identify that we're looking for erasers that are not tools, that are pencils, and that all of these images are being mapped to the same semantic embedding space as our words?
I see. So let's go to the screen so people can see they're out there watching. So you're saying that, like, when I'm searching for something, like, because I know how to word search stuff, but we're searching for an image of something, there's certain kinds of image searches that are very difficult, and this is an example of one of them.
Right. Okay. Right. It definitely is. And there are a couple others. For example, if you take a look at this image over here, how would you describe it?
A big whale and a man swimming, I guess.
Exactly. But you would also expect it to come up with a variety of others. So for example, endangered animals, blue desktop backgrounds, National Geographic.
Oh yeah, that's a problem.
Right? So how do you express that this image has a man and a whale is an endangered animal, and it's also mostly blue? That's a lot of information to be put in one vector.
Definitely.
So a solution that the Bing multimedia team came up with is called Semantic Precise Image Search.
Okay.
It's in relation to Project Dirk, which is a deep image ranking stack. And this is thanks to both the Bing multimedia team and Edward Cui's team. So if we take a look at this, we have a query. In this case, gold butterflies HD background, which is what the user types in. We have the text on the page, which is, let's say, something like HD wallpapers, golden butterflies, something like that. And we also have this image. So we want to be able to represent this image in the same vector space as the queries and
I have
some semantic embedding in terms of this model.
And so it's just like for those that are watching, it's basically a way of taking the image, embedding it into a vector space that you can query against in the same vector space as the query.
Yes.
So basically you're like, you're trying to put these in the same space and then like whichever one's closest, we pick those ones out.
Exactly.
Okay, cool. And so now, I imagine that then you'd have to, for every image that's ever uploaded into Bing, you'd have to put it into this latent space.
Exactly, which is a daunting concept,
right? Yeah, there's a lot of pictures that are uploaded all the
time.
And
not only that, you'd have to process it in terms of the query, in terms of the text on the page, and you'd have to find which images make the most sense and then order them. So it's
a lot of stuff.
It's a large model, large embedding.
So how does ONNX help here?
ONNX Runtime helps by providing a speed up for this model.
Okay.
So ideally what happens is that this specific model came to us with a CAFE model.
Okay.
We converted it to the ONNX model format and deployed it with ONNX Runtime for a 2x speed up. So we reduced their latency by 50% CPUs using Intel's MKLDNN as an execution provider. And with a model like this, especially for Bing, it's already heavily optimized. So these kind of out-of-the-box optimizations that are now in production have really enabled Bing to be able to search in this way.
Because it, like now there's two models that have to be run simultaneously. First, when the image is uploaded, so you can save it into latent space, and then the model that does the comparison between the query and the image in the latent space. So you have two models that need to be running all the time.
Right.
And so you've seen 100, like it's 2x speed up is what you've seen?
Yeah, 2x speed up. And then across the board, we've seen a lot of other really great examples with even more of a speed up.
I see. Okay.
So ONNX Runtime is really taking advantage of this first party equals third party attitude that our senior leadership team has started to employ. And the idea here is you can use ONNX Runtime models, and it is being used at Microsoft across all walks of
just models everywhere, right?
Exactly.
So here's the thing. Where can people go to find out more about this? I'm obviously like, I feel a lot better that I feel like I'm rounded out a little bit more on the ONNX model and the runtime. Where can people go to find out more or maybe even play with some of these things?
Right. So one of the best ways to play with these things is by using Azure Machine Learning. Mm-hmm. So we can now deploy pre-trained ONNX models using ONNX Runtime for inference using Azure Machine Learning. There are some great tutorials, and we'll include some links at the bottom below or on the screen.
Right. Hopefully there's some on the screen right now that we got that we can look at.
So if you go to aka.ms/ONNX Runtime, you'll see this great tutorial about how to deploy ONNX Runtime models using Azure ML for inference. You can always go to GitHub. We have open sourced both of these, both our contributions to ONNX, as well as ONNX Runtime as a scoring engine.
So what if I don't have any models, though? Is there a place where I can get a model to play with?
Exactly. So there is. I'm so glad you asked. If we go to ONNX, ONNX website.
Let's go to the screen here. Yeah, there you go.
We'll see here there are a couple links. One is tutorials, which allow you to look at some conversion tutorials, or you can just go to the ONNX Docker page for those. Mm-hmm. And if you wanted pre-trained models, which it seems like you're asking for, you can go to the ONNX Model Zoo. And here, what you'll see is a set of state-of-the-art models, all categorized in various categories. And you can just pull these immediate models, deploy them using ONNX Runtime, and hopefully on Azure Machine Learning, and
This is pretty cool. I mean, like basically everyone out there watching right now can go to the Model Zoo, download it, download the Docker container, run inference against it, and have it work right away.
Yes.
Okay, this is pretty amazing. I'm pretty excited about it. Thanks so much, Vinitra, for this. This has been amazing. I've had a good time because I've learned a ton about the ONNX model. Thanks so much again for your time. Thanks so much for watching, and we will see you next time. Take care.
Thank you, Seth.